Welcome to this lecture on composite materials for wind energy. My name is Lars Mikkelsen. I'm associate professor at the section for composites manufacturing and testing in the D2 wind and energy system. So I'm going to present how we can look into the composite used in the wind turbine blades. You have earlier seen how the wind turbine is built up and how a blade cross-section is looking, and now we will look into the load-carrying part of that cross-section. So the learning objectives of this lecture here is that you, after this lecture, are able to describe typical mechanical properties of fiber and matrix materials, that you can calculate the stiffness of a unidirectional composite, you can describe how to do a fatigue test, and you can make lifetime prediction of composites for wind turbine blades. But before I go dive into the blades up here on the turbine, then and this turbine is a picture you may have seen in some of the other lectures. This is our D2 turbine, which is a 850 kilowatt turbine with blade length of 25.3 meters. So if you look at a typical turbine, here is a much bigger, more modern turbine, 4.2 megawatt turbine. If you look at the amount of material related to mass that are used in a turbine, then you can see the dominating part is steel and iron, which are mainly located in a tower and in a drivetrain and in a cell on the turbine. Then we have composites and polymers, which are located in the blades. But as you can see, it's much smaller amount regarding weight for that part. And then there are other materials like magnets, copper, aluminum, and some other smaller part of the material. So this is for the turbine counted from the tower and up. But of course, if you look at a wind turbine farm, then we should also think about the foundation. So for onshore wind turbine farm, then you can see actually the dominating amount of material. When we count all material used for a turbine farm, then we are seeing the concrete, and actually the steel and iron is also still a large part. And now it's not only in the tower and in the cell, but also steel used in as reinforcement in the concrete. So you can get more information on this link here, where there are reference to different turbines and then the amount of material used in the different turbine types. So, but we will look into the turbine blade. Of course, a turbine, everything starting with the blades, and one of the major tasks when we are increasing the size of a turbine is to increase the length of the turbine blades. And for that, we need to get, say, a good feeling about how and what requirement do we have for that material. And actually, in the D2 wind and energy system, we are a big group, more than 40 people, which are working just with the composites for wind turbine blades. If we look at a cross-section, then more than 60% of the composites used in that is actually unidirectional laminates, which are mainly located in this region here and are taking up the load for the flapwise loading of the turbine blade. If we zoom in, then we can see this part, this unidirectional laminates located here, which are glass fiber composites. Then we have some core material, some other part where we are more aiming for have a high bending stiffness, but not so much contribution to the overall stiffness of the blade. And then we have the gel coat, which is a surface treatment of our blade. We can also see that some parts have adhesive, which are a polymer, which are gluing different parts of the turbine together, of course, depending on what company are making these turbines. And we have copper wire here for the lighting system, copper wire which are running from the tip of the turbine blade down to the root of the blade. This example is from a 34-meter blade. If you now dive into what is this UD or unidirectional glass fiber composite, which are used in a turbine blade for the load-carrying laminates. This is built up, typically when we talk about a glass fiber composite, then it's built up of what we call non-crimp fabric-based polymer matrix composite. And what we mean with non-crimp is that it's not a woven fabric, but it's a fabric where all, you say, the bundles, glass fiber bundles, are stitched together on a small amount of backing, so secondary-oriented fiber on the backside of this fabric here. So I have, for example, an example on a fabric here. So this is a fabric where we have, you could say, all the UD bundle here with the UD fiber. One bundle normally contain maybe 4,000 fibers, and then on the backside we have some different oriented fibers, which this is stitched to. This fabric, when we make a composite, then we are stacking them together, a number of stacks, and put some resin in. Here's in a cured version. Put that in and let that cure. And based on that, then we get a composite, glass fiber composite material, which are then have all fiber in one direction, or nearly all fiber in one direction, give a high stiffness and high strength in that direction. We will come back to that later. I also have shown an X-ray tomography picture of the cross-section of such a material. If we zoom enough in, then we can see the individual fibers, which for a glass fiber is round fibers, as shown here, with a diameter of typically around 15 to 20 microns. So when you look at the UD part of the composite, so the what we call quasi unidirectional, then 90 to 95% of the fiber is in a UD direction, and then we have a small amount of this backing which the UD fiber are stitched to. But for larger turbine, we also have, you could say, turbine blades where we are using carbon fiber. And the normal way now, the conventional way to include carbon fiber in turbine blades is as pultruded profiles. So an example on a pultruded profile is something seen here. So here we have all fibers in one direction. And actually, the way this is made is by having a number of bobbings with carbon fiber wovings. And that is then drawn through a die and then pultruded into a shape. And this is a continuous manufacturing process. Different for extrusion, where we are pressing the material through, for example, for aluminum profiles, then we cannot press on the fibers. There we need to pull on the final cured material. But then we get materials like this one, which then can be casted into the turbine blade, as seen here, and take up the loads in the turbine. And if you zoom into that, then we can see that we have very aligned fibers, and that the fiber now is not always round, as you can see here, but more some kidney-shaped fiber, and the diameters are also smaller. So this is around 5 to 7, 8 micron, which is smaller than the 15 to 20 micron for the glass fiber. So as I said, when we are increasing the blade length, then we are going from glass, pure glass, to a glass carbon based blade, which are the points up here are showing. So here we have the blade length versus the weight of the blade, and all the blades down here is pure glass fiber. And then we have a couple of blades here, which say plus 100 meter, where we have included carbon fiber. Normally, typically I would say that blades which are more than 80 meter normally contain carbon fiber. Here shown an example on such a big turbine here, with a blade of around 100 meter. The marking here and up here is, each of this marking is 50 meters. So therefore the blade is around 100 meter. The picture is taken from Østerild, our national test center for prototype of turbines. And you could also see one of my colleagues is standing down here, so you can get an idea about the size of this turbine and also the size of the blade used for that. So when we are running a turbine, then the turbine blade will be loaded. And here is an overview of the load, so the aerodynamic load, so the flap-wise load of the turbine blades, which are giving some bending loads of the blade. And then the rotational, so the gravity loads, which are varying, or say varying loads corresponding to the blade direction when the turbine is turning around. So due to this, you see oscillating loads here, and actually here we also will have oscillating loads. For example, because the load, the wind speed will be higher at the tip compared to the bottom, and there may be some other turbine or other part which are shadowing for the wind. So therefore there will be varying loads and maybe also vibration of some parts. So therefore the key material requirement is high fatigue resistance, which are coupled to lifetime, and then high stiffness, which are avoiding bending toward the tower when we have loads on the turbine blade. So now we would like to go into the different constituents in the composite. So we have the fibers, which are the part which are taking up the loads. So here is an equipment which can be used for do single fiber testing. So here we have a magazine where we can put a number of fibers in, and then a small robot which will move the fiber into the test region here. And actually here is hanging one glass fiber. So you can see the clamp down here, which are the end of the glass fiber. And this is the two clamps. In between here, we are doing the tensile test of the glass fiber. So here is seen a number of tests, and all the points here is then when the fiber is breaking. And here is the stress versus the strain. The stress is calculated as the force we are putting on the fiber divided by the cross-section area. So we need the cross-section of each individual fiber. The way that is done in this setup is to do a small vibration test of the fiber before doing the tensile test. And based on the eigenfrequency, then we can calculate the linear density, and based on the density of the material, then we can calculate the cross-section area of our fiber. And based on that, then we can take the load, divide by that, and then find the stresses in the fiber. And the strain is given by the elongation of you could say the movement of one of the clamps here compared to the length of this part here. So this is a very brittle behavior where we can have, you could say, failure at many different locations. And actually the failure here is not really driven by the material, it's more driven by flaws on the fiber. So if you have some flaws, then that will grow. And if you have a large flaw, then that will grow faster and make the fiber fail earlier. If you have small flaws in one other test, then we may have fiber which are stronger. That also has the consequence that actually the strength of the fiber will be depending on how long fiber we are testing. But the stiffness of the fiber, that's rather well defined. And if you follow the standard, ISO standard, and take the stiffness between 0.05 to 0.25% strain, then we will, for glass fiber, find stiffness in the range of 72 to 90 gigapascal. If you look at carbon fiber, then we can see that the strength of the carbon fiber is higher compared to the glass fiber. The stiffness is higher compared to the glass fiber, and there's also much more, as you could say, difference of the different carbon fiber types. But for typical fiber used in the wind turbine industry, then normally we have stiffness from maybe 200 to 240 gigapascal. What we can also see is that the carbon fiber is not linear, so the stress strain curve is bending upward compared to the glass fiber, which are linear in a full test region. And also there is a little more variation from a stiffness from one fiber to the next, because glass fiber, the stiffness of that is amorphous material, so that depends on the constituents in the fiber, while the carbon fiber, that depends on the manufacturing process of the individual fiber, how aligned have the filament been made in the fiber, in the carbon fiber. You can see more details on this in this reference down here. Now, when we go to the matrix material, which is the other part of the composite. So here we have a much more ductile behavior. So compared to the fiber, if we go back to that, you can see the strain to failure is up to max 4%, but very, you could say, undefined. While for the resin system, a typical resin system for a turbine blade, then we have strain to failure, maybe around 4 to 6% strain. It's typical epoxy or polyester. There are also some other thermosetting material which are used as a matrix material. So the stiffness is typically between 2.5 to 3.5 gigapascal, so much lower compared to the fiber material. And the strength is also much lower compared to the fiber. It will be around 50 to 100 megapascal for typical resin system used in turbine blades. So as a summary of the properties, then when we look at the fiber, then we have a stiff and strong but brittle, so give, you could say, very scattered failure of the fiber. If we look at the matrix, then it's is soft, weak, lower strength value, but also ductile, so more reliable strength. If we combine that into a composite, then we get something with properties, strength and stiffness in between the two materials, but the strength is more reliable now, and therefore is also much more ductile behavior compared, or reliable behavior compared to the glass fiber or carbon fiber itself. So now I will go to looking into a simplified, you could say, representation of our UD composite. So we have here is a X-ray tomography picture of a fiber matrix system, a unidirectional composite, and then we can represent that with, you could say, a few bars in a certain direction, and that can even be in a two-dimensional way, be represented by a matrix and a fiber part of our composite with a certain volume fraction of matrix and volume fraction of fiber, where the sum of the volume fraction of fiber plus volume fraction of matrix is equal to 1 for the total material here. So we can do stiffness calculation of the unidirectional composite. So for the stiffness in a fiber direction, which are called a longitudinal direction, here we have ISO strain, so the strain of the two fiber and matrix phases is equal to the other. And based on that, then we can derive that the stiffness of the composite is given by the fiber volume fraction multiplied with the stiffness of fiber plus the volume fraction of matrix multiplied with the stiffness of the matrix. If you take the load in a transverse direction, then we have we can assume ISO stresses, so the same stresses in the two material system, definitely not the same strain, but based on the uniform stresses, then we can derive the inverse rule of mixture, which are looking like this, which are a little similar to this one, but now is inverse of the stiffness we have instead in the rule of mixture. So you can go in and see the deviation of the stiffness in the longitudinal direction to the fiber, which are shown here as an overview, and correspondingly the stiffness in the transverse direction to the fiber direction, which are shown here. So when we look at the two equations for the transverse stiffness and the longitudinal stiffness, if we plot that as a function of fiber volume fraction, which 0 is corresponding to the matrix, pure matrix, and 1 corresponds to pure fiber material, then we reach the stiffness of the fiber and stiffness of the matrix. Then we have a linear variation based on rules of mixture here. So we have that the stiffness will increase linearly from the matrix stiffness to the fiber stiffness. If we then instead take the transverse stiffness, then we will get for the most of the, you could say, veins here, much lower stiffness, which are now given by this curved shape here, which are the transverse stiffness. For typical composites used in wind turbine blades for the UD part, then we will have a fiber volume fraction between 50 to 60%. If we talk about the pultruded profile, then we can even have up to 70, maybe 75% fiber volume fraction. Together with this lecture here, you will also find a link to a Jupyter notebook where you can do the stiffness calculation based on these two equations, and you can even add your own equation if you want to do that. So put in the values for the fiber and a matrix and the fiber volume fraction, and then it will calculate the stiffness in the two direction and also draw the curves for the full range of the fiber volume fraction. So please go in and try out this in order to get a feeling about how the dependency is of the composite stiffness related to the fiber and matrix stiffness. As I said, then the key material properties for the composite for a wind turbine blade is stiffness for bending, and then fatigue regarding the lifetime of our turbine blade, which should be normally considered as minimum 25 years, which are the design criteria for the composite and the material used in the blade. So therefore, if we in some way can find out how many load cycles is required for this 25 years lifetime, then we can find what is then the allowable stress or strain level in the material. And in order to get that, we need to do some fatigue test. Fatigue test is where we take a sample like this one. So this is a fatigue test sample. And then do a fatigue loading of this one. With fatigue loading, we mean that we are oscillating the loads from a minimum to a maximum value with a max value, which we then are reporting often in either the max or the range, is then reported for the fatigue test. We calculate the R ratio, which are defining what loads mode I have put into the fatigue test. So here is defined by the minimum stress divided by the maximum stress. So for this case here is 100 divided by 10, which are minimum loads, so this tension tension fatigue test. And then we have an R ratio equal to 0.1, which are typical R ratio for tensile fatigue test. So the R 0.1, that is shown here as a wet curve here. So the points are the test, so we have put a certain load on the sample, and then we just count the number of cycles until the sample are failing, and then we draw a point. So this is a failing point for one test sample, then we put a higher load on, then we get a other number of cycles to failure, and we do that for a number of tests, and then we get some points. If we plot that is in a single logarithmic diagram as this one, then we will get, you could say, points lying here. If you do it in double logarithmic, then we often see that the point is lying on a straight line. So therefore, we can, you could say, fit the data points with this relation here. It's either number of cycles to failure equal to a fitting constant multiplied with the load level in a power of another fitting parameter. So this is for tensile, and then we have for compression test. For that, we need to have shorter sample in order to make you avoid the sample to buckle when you do the compression loads. We can see up here the definition for R ratio for the compressive loads. Here, the minimum is a minimum negative value here, and then divided by the maximum value. And here, for this load case here, we get R ratio equal to 10, which are typical compression fatigue test. We can see that you could say the test here is going up to maybe 2 million cycles, and 2 million cycles is often what we go up to, and if you do that, keep it in that range, then we can do a test here like this one in 1 to 2 weeks, where the you could say the high number of cycles is take a couple of days, and then in this way we can in 1 or 2 weeks do a fatigue diagram like this one. But if you look at how many load cycles a material is experienced in a turbine, then we have much higher number of cycles. So if you count the number of rotation for a turbine, then we will get something around 50 million cycles. If you take, for example, vibration of the blade, then we get much higher number of cycles. So we will be around this range here. Even though you may think that as not so far distance between this point here to here, then remember that this is a logarithmic scale. So 1 decade here is meaning 10 times longer test time. There's a limitation on how fast we can do the test, because if you do high frequency for the loading, then we are heating up the material, and that's of course not realistic. So based on this fitting here, now we can do some prediction of the lifetime for this material. So this, as I said, the rotation of the rotor and then blade vibration. So here shown two examples on lifetime prediction for tension loading. So the first example is that we are saying that we have a material, we have calculated a material point in our blade that have a load level on 200 megapascal, and then we would like to calculate what lifetime, how many cycles will that material have before it will failing due to fatigue. So from that we need to calculate this into to strains, because that's what I was showing the SN curve for. So we are dividing the stress with the stiffness of our composite material, which here is giving us 45 gigapascal, and that gives 0.44% strain. Then we can put that into our equation for the fitting equation for the number of cycle to failure, and calculate, put that in. And this is giving in percent, because the fitting is done in this percent strain versus number of cycle. And then we, if we put that number in, then we can calculate the number of cycles of failure, which in this case is 260 million cycles. Alternative, we can also turn the equation around and say, okay, if you is aiming for a certain, you could say, lifetime for a material, what is allowable stress level regarding that? So we can for example say that we would like to allow or require that a material can survive the number of rotation for a turbine over 25 years, 50 million cycles. Then we can put that into an equation where we have now isolated the strain value here, put that into the equation here, as seen here. And then we can calculate that the allowable strain level is 0.54%. And if you calculate that into stresses, then this corresponds to 243 megapascal. So this is allowable stress level in a material. Okay, so now we have been through, you could say, the mechanical properties of a composite. So so if you follow through the whole lecture here, then you will learn how to consider the typical mechanical properties of fiber and matrix material using composites, how to calculate the stiffness of a unidirectional composite, how to do a fatigue test, and how to make lifetime prediction of a composite used in wind turbine blades. You're now welcome to look into the derivation of some of the equation used in this lecture here, or go in and work with the Jupyter notebook to calculate your own stiffness properties based on some, you say, other composite cases. Thank you very much.